Vince Warren is with the Center for Constitutional Rights. Nice to see you. Let's hop right into this. The judge found in the New York case that New York City and, in fact, the New York Police Department had engaged in illegal and discriminatory actions, violating both the 14th Amendment and the 4th Amendment for people who were stopped and frisked. What exactly happened?
Well, the New York City Police Department instituted this program called Stop and Frisk. And what it did was it stopped people on the streets of New York City. And under the Constitution, you can only stop people if you have a reasonable, articulable suspicion, a reason for stopping somebody that they might have done something wrong. The court found that this massive program, which stopped over 5 million people over several years, was constitutionally infirm because, in fact, the police were stopping people for no articulable reason whatsoever. And what makes it even worse is that the police were stopping people primarily because they were Black or Latino and not primarily because they thought they had done something wrong. So when the Center for Constitutional Rights filed this legal challenge, and we ended up doing a 9.5-week trial on the case, the court clearly found that the practice of stop and frisk as practiced by the New York City Police Department was essentially a 10-year walking constitutional violation in which over 87% of the people that the police department stopped were African-American and Latino. But 90% of the people that they stopped didn't even get a ticket, did nothing wrong whatsoever. They were essentially stopping innocent people on the basis of race.
And that was looking at a large number of people. It was something like more than 4 million people between 2004 and 2012. That 90% number, those are people who didn't get a ticket, didn't get arrested, nothing happened to them at all. They were just let go. They were essentially were innocent of anything.
Yeah, and it was closer to 5 million people over a period of time. And the reason why we know that is as a part of the lawsuit, we obtained the police stop and frisk data. The police weren't telling us how many people they were stopping. These were massive numbers of people, over 600,000 people in 2011 alone. And what was happening is for all of these people that they were stopping, you would think, because the idea was that they were supposed to be stopping people because they were doing crimes, you would think that some meaningful percentage of these people would go to court, would get a ticket, would be arrested for some particular reason. But it was roughly 90% of the people had done nothing wrong. So it's essentially a 90% fail rate for this program for New York City.
I remember the mayor saying that there was a value in instituting fear in the community that they would be stopped. He went on to say, like, that would encourage people not to carry a weapon with them. Isn't that a fair argument?
No, it's not a fair argument for a couple of reasons. Number one, a mayor should not intimidate an entire community to cower in their bedrooms because they're afraid that the police are going to stop and frisk them for no reason, number one. Number two, the mayor, which was Michael Bloomberg at the time, was sending out this major fiction that stop and frisk was actually reducing crime, and he was looking at the declining crime numbers and saying stop and frisk was the reason. Of course, what we found out was that the crime rate had been declining prior to stop and frisk. Number two, after our lawsuit and after the police department stopped doing stop and frisk, they essentially almost ceased that practice at the end of the lawsuit, the crime rate still went down. So stop and frisk had nothing to do with controlling crime rates. It had nothing to do with any disincentives to carry guns and weapons. And in fact, during the entire program of stop and frisk, the percentage of people stopped where weapons were found was less than 0.02%. I mean, this is a tiny fraction. You could randomly pick people and get a higher percentage of someone carrying a weapon than doing it by race.
What was the impact on the relationship between the police and the community? Because stop and frisk was so angered so many people who were living in the community. I would imagine long term it was not helpful for fighting crime.
Yeah, I think the best way to put it is that for, imagine what it would be like for any community where parents are concerned that when their children go to school, they might get stopped and harassed by the police department. Or imagine what it's like for a partner or spouse when they're going to work, not knowing if they're going to be able to come home, or sending somebody out for a quart of milk without getting harassed by the police. That definitionally sours relationships between communities and police officers. And it's not just a black and white issue. Anybody that is under that type of social control, for absolutely no reason, having done nothing wrong, can't possibly be able to build a positive relationship with the people that are looking at the entire community as criminals, when of course that's not true. So it was a disaster. And after Mayor de Blasio came in the election and a new police commissioner was brought on, Bill Bratton, that program ceased. I think the work is still happening to build relationships with the police department. But we have to remember that when you institute these types of policies, it takes years and frankly sometimes even generations to rebuild trust between police and community members.
Vince Warren is with the Center for Constitutional Rights. Thanks for joining us. Appreciate it, Vince.
Great to be here. Thank you.